and some really interesting things there about how to get the message across and train the users, make it fun, make it relevant. I just wanted to touch on one other thing that we really see is it's the awareness piece. So I think Stuart's going to cover this again after me around the CISP, but it is who in your organisation is making the rest of the business aware of what's out there. So we can train people on systems, we can train people on what to spot, but was not to scare, but maybe to inform and to get people bought into the fact that this is not something that we do. We're here just to kind of put IT in their way or put systems or processes in their way, but actually it's an awareness. And again, as Mel touched on, well, things that happen in their personal life can happen and affect them in their business life. So really promoting that awareness. We had an incident, and I'm not going to name names, but an incident of a lady, and this is where, for me, the training about what the issue is or how to go about your working life in a secure way really helps. And what sounds like a very basic issue turned into a big problem for that business. So the lady received had her bank transaction intercepted. And the reason why she had a bank transaction intercepted is because she worked in finance, and every day that she went to go onto the banking website, she Googled the banking website. She never saved it as a favourite the first time she started speaking to the bank. She Googled it, and she chose the top link. On this particular day, it was a Google ad that had been paid for by someone with malicious intent. And even though she had a keypad, it was long enough between the keypad, the digit code going in, along with her password, that the transaction was intercepted. And they were able to stop the transaction in the end, but the sum of money was in the tens of thousands that could have gone away. And that wasn't necessarily to do with the fact that she wasn't aware, it was maybe just a very straightforward, she hadn't saved that URL as a bookmark in whichever was her chosen browser. A very simple thing, but actually comes back to policy, potentially, but awareness, what that actually means, what Google Ads means. It's some fundamentals going back to the basics of IT. And training is fantastic, but we have to repeat it. So most businesses now spend a lot of time and a lot of money on inducting their employees in the correct manner. And we see a lot of, if you have on LinkedIn, people start their day and, oh, I've got fantastic working for a new business. Look at all this IT equipment they've got. And they've got iPads, Macs, phones, new desks, new jumpers, whatever it might be on their desk. Fantastic. And we train them in induction, but are we training them, as Melinda said, every 6 months, every 3 months in the right way about systems, not only about process, but what's out there, but also about how to do the basics. What do I do? Am I allowed to stick this stick in my laptop? And what do I do before using it? What process do I follow? And making sure that they're doing that. On the back of that, I want to touch on a subject that is one of those things that's been given a buzzword over the past few years of shadow IT. Any sort of quick show of hands, everyone know what shadow IT is? Melody does. Excellent. Thank you. So just to kind of reiterate, in business, we're now employing a lot of people who've come up through the educational establishments and are used to using technology and are used to finding ways to use technology to help them make their day easier, help them achieve a result faster, do different things. And what that means for businesses, particularly those businesses who, like we've mentioned before, have had IT around for a number of years, maybe the systems haven't moved on as fast as people would like them to move on. And as we all know, there's an app for everything. But is there an app for everything and we can control it? So shadow IT is where people are finding solutions to process problems or procedure problems or speed issues, and they're coming up with their own solutions to that. So the IT department doesn't know about it, potentially. So hence we get the term shadow IT. What are we going to do to control those applications? And therefore, we've got an insider threat. They've done it for the right reasons because, again, as Melinda said, people are willing to do a good job. They want you to be the A player in that business and to succeed and move the business forward. But is it at risk of your data? Is it at risk of losing that data? So the classic examples that we see are things like Dropbox. You might have cloud storage, you might have ways of storing your data, but actually, who's in your business is using Dropbox? Perfectly legitimate, perfectly legal application to use, but if we're putting corporate data into that, how do I know? So I've been able to work on a piece of software, for example, just to kind of give you an idea how to mitigate that. A piece of software that looks at the firewall logs that for the data that's going in and out of your business, and it matches that, those firewall logs, against 14,000 odd applications that are known and internet. So I can see straight away that I've got a picture that's building up that says, these are the applications that are used by my business. Now maybe the top five or six out of the top 10 are going to be the ones that I've said, no problem. You can use Office 365, you can use SharePoint, you can use all these great applications. However, what are these ones? Then from there, we can go, we can track that, why are they using this? And then suddenly I see a spike of data on a Thursday evening of data going to Dropbox by maybe a sales employee or something, and on Friday get his resignation. So what was that data? Why was there a spike in an application I can't control? I've lost data. What is he going to do with that data? Is it going to be a competitive risk, or is it going to be a cyber risk? Well, definitely I've got some kind of breach there. So shadow IT is becoming a real bit of a problem, because those guys, I said before, the millennials or whatever, generation Y, X, Z, whatever you want to call them, they're coming through to business and finding ways. So we have to mitigate that. That's my place, isn't it? 1 second. Yes. So, in the same way, we can talk about third-party access. Now, I'm not sure, did you all see the piece of it on the BBC News a couple of weeks ago about the Australian defence arm? I can't remember the terminology they used. So, third-party access. Who has access to your network? Who has access to your data? What are they coming into your network to do? Because once they're in, once they've got some kind of access to your network, log on, a VPN, or whatever it might be, they are an insider. So the issue with the Australian defence was that a contractor lost 30 gigabytes of data based on a new fighter jet and some naval vessels that they were working on. It wasn't a sort of, it was commercially sensitive, but it wasn't publicly an issue. However, they lost 30 gigabytes of data. And why did they lose it? It's because the third-party contractor's laptop hadn't, the software that it was using hadn't been patched for 12 months. So it comes back to fundamentals and classics, but actually, can we control the people that are accessing our network other than the people we can see sat at desks in our office on a daily basis? So third-party access is becoming, you know, it's a really big issue, because we know that not all businesses can fulfill their business needs just by the people that are sat in front of them or people who work remotely. We have to allow other people into our business to fulfill tasks, do point projects, that kind of thing. But we have to be able to secure them. We have to be able to give them access to the data we need. So going back to what Amar said, absolutely, people still need to be given permission to do stuff, but how are we doing that? What equipment are we providing? Customer I went to last week, they had a warehouse where they were fulfilling orders. Fantastic. Retail establishment, doing really well. They just put a new system in. However, the laptop that sat in their warehouse was owned by the warehouse, and they had full access from that laptop into their corporate system, the one that they just paid over £100,000 for, and they had access to put orders on straight into the network tool, and they had no control over the antivirus on that laptop, the patching of that laptop, the person who was logged onto it, the different people who logged onto it, who walked past it, what was my peripheral physical security. So again, third-party access, massive problem. Some of the ways that we can mitigate it. I wanted to just touch on some of the things that Amar said and kind of move on from that. He's absolutely right. Most businesses these days are based around Active Directory. So, as he talked about, there are lots of accounts in Active Directory. And if your directory or your organizational structure has been around for a long time, and he's right, we see it. We look at customers, we go and audit a customer to take them onto into our support. We don't take them onto support until we've been through their network, had a look at it, worked out what they may or may not be doing. And the classic thing we look at is, there's a group in Active Directory that's called Domain Admins. I don't know how many people in the room are familiar with that group. And you'll be surprised how you expect probably to see one or two accounts in that, maybe one or two more depending on the circumstances. But that group is God. The amount of businesses we go into and we see a list of people from, you know, people in sales, people in technical jobs, or whatever it might be, in that group, because at some point in the history of that business, something was installed that didn't work properly, so they said, well, we'll stick in that group for now, that'll get us over the problem, get them working and we'll come back to it. They never go back to it. It's always the group, that's always the issue. And that's the first thing we look at. And to kind of turn that around in terms of just enough access, we have seen, particularly from a ransomware point of view, we've seen people, ransomware, targeting the accounts that are used to run backups. So, of course, a backup account needs to be God because it's got to get access to all the data to get it into whatever backup solution that your business uses. But actually, if it targets the backup account first, that account's got to be stable, it's got to have a password that's used regularly. If I target that, I'm starting to now encrypt the backups first, unbeknownst to anybody else, and then I attack the PCs. No problem, the business says I can go back to my backups. Oh, they were compromised first. So it's really about what can I do about cutting that access down, changing those passwords regularly, and then going back to this just enough access. Absolutely, the people in your organization are given permissions to do their job. This we cannot avoid. They have to do that. But are they given just enough, or is it too much? And just going back to what Amar said, he was absolutely right. People move jobs, people get different permissions. The secretary, is exactly the classic example there. And also, we see this come from a different point of view. Someone goes, I've got a new user, new member of the department, great. Ah, Sally's got the right access, copy her. But are we checking what's in Sally's account? Are we checking the directories that Sally was given access to 6 months ago to get a job done for another department temporarily? Or was it removed again afterwards? So many times we see people getting given access, but is there a time limit put on it? Is there a scope put on it? Who authorised that? Another key issue, actually, who's allowed to authorise the increase in permissions? Who's allowed to say, yes, that's absolutely fine, what time limit am I going to put on it? Who's going to manage that? Of course, it then comes back down to IT, and IT go, I haven't got time, I'm still firefighting these backups that are causing me a problem. But these are the things that where we can mitigate access, these are the things where we can mitigate permissions, these are the things where we can say, you only have just enough access to do the role that you need to do. We're not being a god, we're not being draconian, but actually, ransomware, as Amar said, ransomware attacks the things you've got access to. So the smallest amount of data, databases, whatever it might be, you've got access to, the more we can reduce risk, mitigate the insider threat. So, there's been a number of people talking about policies this morning, and I absolutely agree. I come from an infrastructure background, and I totally endorse what Amar said. I'm not a massive one for writing documents, but I have to, because it's one of those things that we have to get around. If you've got people who like writing documents, then great, it's good. However, we've seen a number of different ways of doing it. It depends on the organisation. Some people say, actually, I'll read this document, I'll read the policy, it's going to be a great, it's going to be adhered to by everybody. And everyone's going to sign at the bottom and go, yeah, that is enshrined in the nature of our business and we're going to be able to protect ourselves. But where we're seeing policies potentially not necessarily being that kind of, this is what you have to do, follow it to the letter, or we're going to come down like a ton of bricks. We're seeing a better way of doing policies in the sense of we create a framework for what's going on, and then we're going to give you guidelines on how to do your business. So it becomes a kind of a crossover between a policy and a procedure. So I'll give you an example. Again, we're going back to the changing workforce. People like to work from home. People like to have work flexibly. They come into the office at different times. So what is their parameters around that? Have you got a system in place that says, great, you can come into the office, but actually, based on your job role, the door entry system only allows access to that particular part of the building, but the rest of the building remains secure, and I've got CCTV turned on. You could have a different one where we've got Wi-Fi policy. So Wi-Fi is a classic example. We all love it. We all swear by it. We all need it. It's almost seen as now the Maslow's hierarchy of needs. It's the next thing after being able to breathe air, having Wi-Fi available. But actually, does it need to be on in the middle of the night? I had a long discussion with a customer last week who turned his Wi-Fi off at 6 o'clock in the evening and didn't come back on again until 6 in the morning because the business was 9 to 5. Why does it need to be on? All those people who work in your business who've got mobile phones and personal devices or whatever it might be, who've got access. Yeah?
Quite often, the Wi-Fi providers will tell you to keep it on constantly because otherwise
it affects your speed. And quite often, there's updates on patching and
things that need to be done overnight when the business is busy.
Yeah, no, absolutely, great point. And thank you for raising that. So the way we're seeing that happened is the Wi-Fi isn't actually off, it's just not broadcasting. So the devices themselves never actually get turned off. It just turns out off the facility for someone to connect to it. So as a device on the network, it's still there to be able to be patched. So absolutely right, and I'll come on to a second about why that's absolutely critical. So you're right, absolutely. There are, you might get a piece of information from IT, because actually, does it make IT's life easier? But actually, I want to turn my Wi-Fi off in the middle of the night because I don't want someone sat in the car park because the Wi-Fi reaches that far to be able to do things on my network. Sorry?
Turning off your broadcast if you're sick is not a security event.
No, but it's one option to kind of mitigate it.
Not for anyone who wants to get on.
Well, there are a number of, it depends on what product you're using and how that goes about it, but there are policies that we can do to allow people not to connect to it. So it does depend on the device that you're using. So, for example, there's the Cisco Meraki devices that then you can prevent people from getting on, and the policy means the device is still available and the users can't actually connect to it. Okay, I mean, it depends. We'll maybe discuss a bit further afterwards. The other thing I just wanted to mention about policies, and it may not necessarily directly related to IT, is about insider threats. Is what are we telling people when people phone? So IT is telephony is seen as an IT piece of equipment. And not necessarily directed, but actually, what information are we giving out? What information are people being able to extract from the person answering the telephone to give over names, email addresses, that kind of thing? Which then gives them a lead into being able to potentially cause some kind of a threat. Sort of a different way of looking at an insider threat, but an insider threat is not training people on what information to give out over that telephone call. In any presentation that we talk about cybercrime, we have to talk about patching, and again, It's that love it or hate it. It's the thing that IT have to do. It's the thing that we have to make sure that we're on top of. And this goes back to the awareness. So are IT aware of the latest threats? So I mentioned the Wi-Fi earlier. We've had a bit of discussion around that. So some of you may know that 2 weeks ago, a Belgian university researcher did manage to compromise a security protocol called WPA2. WPA2 is widely seen as probably the most common method of securing your Wi-Fi, your access points, and so on. And there's no known, as far as I checked last night, so there's any known vulnerabilities or people exploiting this vulnerability out there on the internet. But actually, it's something that we need to look at how we're going to patch that. How does that information get into the business? Make sure we're aware of that and then push that out. So a number of providers still haven't provided updates for either access points or phones. And in this situation, they're saying, or it's being known, that Android phones are particularly vulnerable to this because certain Android phones or manufacturers aren't receiving patches or aren't receiving updates as much as other manufacturers. So if you've got a Samsung or a Sony, are they all receiving the same level of updates? Now, in Windows, this was patched some time ago, but in terms of the access points, it wasn't. But again, it's not just about patching the easy stuff like Windows or Windows devices, it's everything else. So are we patching those old versions of Adobe Reader, Java, ActiveX, all the things that kind of go to make up someone's daily life? And the other thing we see a lot of issue around is you might have a very legitimate piece of software that provides, I don't know, a database or some application into your business, but if that application is provided by a company, but in order to support the application or deliver it, there's other components provided by other third-party vendors, maybe it's a web interface or some other kind of information, that also needs to be patched, but isn't necessarily patched as part of the update or patching regime of that. So you need to have systems in place to detect those software installations and make sure that those are patched. So things like Apache web service, that kind of stuff, older versions can be very vulnerable to attacks, particularly from insider threats. We spend a lot of time talking about what we do on the internet. We spend a lot of time talking about content that we browse and content filtering and things that we have to access through a corporate firewall. Obviously, not everyone's always sat behind a corporate firewall, so we need to make sure that those firewall policies travel with us. I wanted to talk very quickly about modern firewalling. We talk about what's allowed in, what's allowed out, which this is all stuff that's been around for a long time. What we're seeing now is that people are actually needing to either extend the wife, the capabilities of the firewall onto the device that you take with you, making sure that policy stays with you, making sure that the access list or the application firewall goes with you wherever you are. But then we want to talk about people doing sandboxing. So the latest generations of firewalls now will take the file that you're downloading, be that in an email or maybe in a web download, look at that file before it's released to the user, open it in a sandbox environment so that it can be scanned and run through a date change. So if there's some kind of 0 day or date related exploit embedded in that, it'll run through a date change, maybe of 100 years or something, to try and detonate it, scan it with a number of different engines, and then only then release it back to the user. So it's worth considering, does your firewall have that capability? Are we tracking those downloads? So whilst it might be just a download, but actually how much data is your business downloading? So for example, if you're a digital agency, a lot of graphics coming down, a lot of things that you can upload, download in and out of your business on a daily basis, we have to make sure that all those are scanned. That's before the user receives it, before it gets inside your organization, it has been checked and it has been potentially mitigated. And the other thing that, from an insider point of view, from a data breach point of view, there's a lot of talk, we've talked about this previously, is you can attach data to many things. We talked about different applications, we talked about people doing applications from the shadow IT point of view. But actually, webmail is still a thing where someone could legitimately go and attach this spreadsheet for the right reasons to send it home to work on it. But actually, do we allow that? We might say as a policy, going back to policies, we can allow people access to get onto their Gmail or Hotmail because that we're going to be open to our users. But actually, what are we allowing to do that in? So modern firewalls now will kind of have an application level firewalling capability within that to say, yes, you can log onto it, but no, you can't attach spreadsheets. No, you can't attach things to that email. You can still read your email, you can still read your Facebook posts, but you can't post, you can't upload pictures. So you have a granular level of control over what people are doing. Rather than saying, yes, you can't get on Facebook, and no, you can't, we're going to say what we can and can't do within the context of that particular application. So very good way of going, still maintaining the culture, still maintaining people's kind of willingness to do work, but actually controlling their access to the fine level of fine level. Which leads me on to kind of data loss prevention. We spend a lot of time talking about this. We spend a lot of time sort of looking at how we can prevent data loss. It's, again, going back to what Amar said, you've got an organization where people need to have access to data in order to do their role. But so we can't bar access to all data. So what can I do? What else can I do to that data to secure it, to not let it leak out, to prevent loss, prevent a breach? And I think we've touched on a little bit earlier, so document tagging, emails, classification, policies that live with that document no matter where it goes. So there's certain systems out there that you can we can talk about that as you create a document, the business will assign by default a policy to that. You can then assign a higher level of policy that might say, fine, you can be emailed internally, but it's not allowed to be, if it has to be emailed externally, that person can't forward it on, they can't print it, all they can do is read the email and delete it. So document tagging to try and reduce the risk of data breach and to circumvent issues and trying to, and again, going back to kind of the firewalling in conjunction with those systems, do we allow emails or attachments to go out of the business with things like credit card numbers in, national insurance numbers, driving license numbers, all this kind of personal data that will obviously around the GDPR, for example, that we, if it's flagged up that it has that information in it, it puts a high level classification on the document, prevents even further from people taking actions on that document that you don't want the business to be put at risk by. It's in a presentation like this, and it's with a spread of businesses of different sizes. Systems monitoring is always, for me, is a bit of a difficult subject because people tend to sort of look at system monitoring as a kind of, sometimes it's a nice to have, sometimes it's absolutely critical. If you're a big business, absolutely monitoring people's behaviour, looking at what's a normal network activity is absolutely key. But it's a difference of opinion and can very much be driven by cost. But a lot of things I've already talked about probably are already available in most businesses. Every firewall has some kind of logging in it. Every Active Directory we talked about before has a lot of logging in it. You've just got to know what to look for and to be able to alert on it. It has to be there. It has to look for those trends. More modern applications, as I said before, will look at the behaviour of what is a sort of effectively create a baseline of activity on the network. Look at what is normal for Dave and accounts to do, what is looking for normal for Sally the PA to do. But then actually, so if something goes anomaly, goes outside of those norms, it can then alert. It can then look at what's going on. Maybe it was the added information to Dropbox, the added information to other applications that we don't have control of. Why did it happen? We can look at the peaks, we can look at the alerts, we can look at the differences, rather than alerting on everything, and be a bit more proactive. So it has to be there, but it has to be right. The problem with anything like emails, if you get too many emails, you start to stop reading and you pick out the ones that you think need to be answered first. Same with alerting. You can't, if you over alert, people will start to just get crowded by noise, and you have to pick out the peaks and the troughs. That's where system monitoring isn't something you can just put in and leave. You have to look at it, put it in, tweak it, monitor it, and then get the best out of it as you move forward. And before I kind of round up, I kind of wanted to just kind of use the title of Don't Forget the Basics. We talk about a lot of things. We talk about data, we talk about systems that can prevent issues. But actually, we have to do all of that, plus all the things we were already doing. Antivirus alerting, what PCs are not getting updated with Windows updates. Are people changing their passwords regularly? Are they choosing a good password? What's our password policy? We've got anti-spammer players, we've got anti-phishing players. All the things that we've always done or should always been doing still need to continue, still need to be alerted upon, still need to be checked. Similar thing, you mentioned Wi-Fi quite a bit. Changing the passwords, depending on how you've got a Wi-Fi set up. Are you changing your guest password? Who's got access to guest pad? How often do you change it? Those sort of things are we stop talking about, but actually we still need to keep doing. So it's absolutely about not stopping and doing any of that, but actually increasing it. And to sort of bring us to close, I think my previous two speakers have mentioned Cyber Essentials. And particularly I want to mention Cyber Essentials Plus, just to kind of reiterate that for everybody. That process does internal vulnerability scanning. So looking at the systems that are on a network, builds of your PCs, your devices that are on the network, how secure are they, what patch level are they at, what are all those pieces of software that you're running, how are they looking at. So that is a fantastic way of mitigating that insider threat, because it is doing all the work that you need to do, and you're not going to pass that until you've reached a good percentage or 80 or above percent of that questionnaire and mitigated those risks. So absolutely key. And finally, we always have to mention this in a presentation. I think certainly between now and May, we have to mention GDPR. So my colleagues have mentioned it before. I'm not going to go on about it, but absolutely, we all have to take insider risks, insider threats seriously. Even in an IT business such as ourselves, we hold customer backup data. So what does that mean for us? It's all encrypted, but what else have we got to do? What else have we got to look at to mitigate the risk as a data processor or a data controller to prevent any risk of fine or penalty come next year? So I'm not going to go on about it. I think we've all probably heard enough of our favourite for that acronym. But to bring it to close, thank you very much for listening. Hope that was useful. Hope that kind of had to give you some thought, idea into how to mitigate some risk we talked about. And thanks for the invite. We'll hand back over to you.
Thank you very much, Tim. Right, last on the agenda was an input by Chief Inspector Vanessa Smith, but unfortunately due to her absence, we're lucky to have Stuart Hyde here, who is an ambassador for CIS. Whilst we will go out and lead and actively promote it, we're lucky enough that Stuart, with an extensive policing background, he's well known in the private sector as well, he's come to give you an input. So please, take everything you say and take the opportunities that come to you.
Thank you very much indeed. We'll just fire this thing up. Yeah, do you want to
sit out?
Okay, are you all sitting comfortably? You'll notice that I'm not Vanessa Smith. Unfortunately, she can't be here today, and I was going to use the opportunity to give a big thank you to her as she moves on to a slightly different role. So I'll do that to start with. Vanessa is one of the people in sort of the managerial roles within the police that actually gets cyber. She understands the problems and pitfalls of businesses, of policing, of academia, all trying to work together. And I've really enjoyed working with her over the last year or so. I'm glad to see that she's staying in this world in a slightly different role, but I'm really pleased that she's able to do that. And I'd just like to say a big thank you on behalf of the business lead for the CISP, the Cyber Sharing Partnership, to Vanessa, hope she makes a swift recovery and is back helping to drive cyber security across the globe. Okay, our conference today is about the insider threat. That's both locally and nationally and internationally. It doesn't matter where this person is that's going to attack your business or where this individual is that's going to make a mistake. So all of the principles that we've talked about today have been about trying to ensure that you have the safest, most protective environment for your data and for your cyber. One of the things I do is help out regional business lead for the CISP, Professor Adam Beaumont. Adam Beaumont is the CEO of a company called AQL. AQL should stand for Equality Life, but it actually stands for AQ is a solution, so it's solution limited, and it's about trying to find solutions. And Adam's prime purpose is to try and develop through things like the Northern Powerhouse, a member of that, through Leeds Digital, to try and encourage businesses to be safer, better, and more effective at managing themselves in this region, particularly within Leeds. Some of the things that they're involved with, looking after data, not just for large organisations, but for countries as well, and also providing SMS-type management facilities. So some of you will no doubt be receiving SMSs before you go, or texts before you have a doctor's appointment or a dental appointment. That's the sort of service that AQL do. But Adam's primary role in this is because he wants to create and be part of a safer internet, not just across Leeds or West Yorkshire, but across the whole of the region, and make this a safe place for people to do business, because businesses are much better informed, and other organisations, whether they're universities, health, schools, or charities, are better protected and much more safe to do work with. And that's, if you like, the ambition that we have. By way of background, I've worked in the police for 30 years, now retired. But throughout that, I've been involved in things like action fraud, which I'll talk a bit about later. And I also currently run the High-Tech Crime Consortium. This is an organisation of about 1,500 cyber investigators across the globe. It's a not-for-profit, it's not a commercial organisation, but it helps them to share information about different problems they might face in trying to get digital forensics to prove something or even to disprove something. Something that I've certainly been involved with for a very long time. And it works because industry and business, so private investigators and law enforcement investigators, work together to find solutions that help to bring people to justice. And that's the same sort of thing as the CISP that we'll talk about later on. It's about people working together to make the cyber environment safer. Tim kindly gave you a bit of a spoiler for this next shot, but you've heard of Maslow's, where we start off, you know, we need food, water, shelter, warmth, we need safety, we then try and You know, we want love in our life, we want to have a partnership with our children, we want to get to self-realization. But now, unfortunately, all that has changed. Because we won't even start any of this until we've got our Wi-Fi and our battery. And the first question we ask when we go into a cafe or a restaurant or a pub is not, you know, what's the beer of the month? Or what's the finest white wine you've got? Or which Marlborough Sauvignon Blanc are you serving? It's, can I have the Wi-Fi code? Almost before you've gone in, your eyes are now looking across the walls for that little sign, Wi-Fi code, 12345. Or if it's a French one, it's about 30 numbers long. And you've got to try and read it without your glasses. So that's what we do. That's how thirsty we are now for internet access. That's everybody, 60 million of us just in this country, trying to do that. So, the question is, and it's been posed by a couple of people so far, is why bother? Why should we bother with trying to make our lives safer or our cybersecurity safer? Surely for most companies it's, well, that's IT's fault. It's not my responsibility as an employee, as a chief executive officer, as a call center manager, or as an engineer. That's all to do with the IT department, so why should I be bothered? And that's a question that we're going to ask, particularly when there's far more exciting things to do. We just want to chill out, relax, do our job, or we want to go and have some fun and games, entertain ourselves, go out for meals. Why should I bother with my company's cybersecurity? And some people will turn around and say, well, cybersecurity, that just costs money, particularly as a small business. Why would I invest in that when actually it's far more important to protect my bottom line by going out, selling things, delivering services, and making money? And that's a very easy alternative to thinking about your cyber. If the money's coming in, we don't really need to worry about our data, or the data that we hold on behalf of somebody else, or somebody else who holds our data, or even more importantly, somebody else who holds our customers' data. But I think we know that behind all this, there is a risk. There is a risk that one day something will happen, and you will have seen over the last few years quite a few hits. Those that you remember the TalkTalk breach a year or so ago, quite a lot of data was lost. And if you want an incentive, just picking up on something that Tim was talking about, if you want an incentive for thinking about GDPR next year, use these figures. When the ICO looked at TalkTalk, they ended up fining them about 300,000. Under the new rules for GDPR, the maximum fine is now 4% of your international turnover, not your profit before tax, after tax, or your gross or net turnover. So the difference for TalkTalk was 300,000 old style, 53 million new style. So you take an average school budget of 4 or 5 million, take 4% out of that if you get it wrong, and you start to feel just how much that could affect a company or an organisation. And it doesn't matter if it's a charity, if it's an education authority, if it's the police, if it's the fire service, or if it's UK PLC. Though that is a huge change in the way in which the government is going to enforce the way we look after our data. So we know that all these things are going on. Fraud hits 1 billion. We know that people are using the internet to try and lure children into doing things that are criminal acts and then publish it. We know that large companies and small companies are being hacked and data is being stolen. Those of you keeping up with the news at the moment, the bad rabbit is out there. Not so much in this country because of the support that we have here, but certainly attacking companies in Russia and Ukraine. A little bit more about the bad rabbit in a while. So we know all this is going on. So if we want to sort of see, well, what's the whole picture of cybercrime? And last year we did some research on the Yorkshire region. Let's have a bit of the global before we exit stage left. Europol does an annual assessment of what's going on the internet. It's called IOCTA, International Organized Crime Threat Assessment. It's available online. You can look it up. Just put IOCTA and Europol in 2017, and you'll get the latest version. And these are some of the things they've identified. Malware, convergence of cyber and terrorism coming together, people using it to create fear, hatred, or in order to cause disruption. Data breaches, sexual coercion of minors, using it to lure children into committing offence or being the victim of offences. Card not present fraud, when you get your details stolen and used against you. Card present fraud, where you have a different, your card details are on a different card and money is extracted from your account. And obviously the dark net, the dark web, all that stuff that you don't find on Google, it's there, and people using it for criminal activity. So this is what Europol is saying, and this can affect any country, any company, any organisation. It doesn't discriminate between people that don't charge and people that do charge. So, knowing that risk, we are increasing our bandwidth. We are putting more and more bandwidth out there for people so that you can get multi-gigabyte access, so that you're almost into a terabyte. Lots and lots of data that you can download very, very quickly. We're putting more down into the cloud, making sure that people can leave stuff in places that they don't know where it is. Do you know where your data is? Even if it's something like a Facebook, a Twitter account, that your data on that could be in one of several countries. Even if you're using something like Dropbox, that can be in different parts of the globe. You don't actually necessarily know where it is, even if you've got faith in the company doing it. There's more devices being used. We're now getting on to 4 to 5 devices connected to the internet for every human being on the planet. And if you start thinking about all the stuff that you've got connected at home, whether it's toys, cars and stuff, there's an awful lot of activity going on and an awful lot of connectedness. Each one creating a risk. Oh, sorry, I went on to that. We've also got less time. We're all busy people. We've got more to do, more demands on us to look at our emails, keep ourselves up to date when we're in work, when we're not at work. We do home, we do play, we keep up with our social media. We've got a lot more disrupting the way we think, yet we're still trying to find ways of keeping people safe. And of course, there's more nasties. For example, the Petya attack, the WannaCry attack that hit primarily health service within the UK, although it was a global attack. People are spending time writing this stuff and making it even more nasty. So we do have to protect ourselves. And then we're connecting everything up before. So we've got the cars that we're connecting, baby monitors. You no longer just shove it in the wall. You can actually talk to the child. You can play music. You can change the lighting. You can put a drone up, connect it to the internet, you can have access and entry points, change your lights. You can do just about anything you can connect to the internet. And of course, one or two of you have seen this before. That's my favourite up there. It's called Peggy. It's a clothes peg that you can connect to the internet. And you put your washing up and you put Peggy on top and you wander off down to the shops. And when your clothing is dry, it will tell you. How wonderful is that? How have we survived without Peggy? Even more, it's got a sensor on there, so it will tell you if it's raining. So what could be better than that? Just what we need here. Something to tell us it's raining, so we could go and hide somewhere, and then Peggy will let us know. That's the sort of extreme end. Other ends in the States, people using mattresses connected to the internet to see how your sleep pattern is, whether you snore, make noises at night, things like that. All of which, all that detail is available to you. It's also available to everyone else as well. So private investigators using the data from that in order to see whether perhaps the mattress is being used for different purposes at different times of day when it should be static with nobody on it. I think you can guess the rest of that. So we are connecting everything. We want more bandwidth. We want more places to hold our data down in the cloud. And on top of that, we have a whole load of criminal activity that takes place. I'm not going to read through each of these. We've got viruses, denial of service attacks. There's a transport system at the moment, live, that's currently suffering a denial of service attack, not locally, although sometimes that's difficult to spot. Theft and ransomware. You saw the WannaCry ransomware. Pay us some money or you don't get your data, it's all encrypted. On that, I would say one resource there that we haven't talked about today is called nomoreransom.org. It's been set up through Kaspersky, the Dutch police, and now Europol, and now the National Crime Agency and National Cyber Security Center are using it as well. It's probably your first port of call if you want information about handling a ransom. Simply called nomoreransom.org. Luckily, even though it's created by the Dutch through a Russian excellent cybersecurity company, it's all in English. And it will give you decryption keys, probably the best selection of them. On top of that, we've got fraud, subterfuge, grooming that I talked about with children, blackmail, extortion, indecent images, viruses, a whole range of criminal stuff that takes place, some of which gets recorded, and I would guess probably most of it doesn't. So we've got all those things going on. Are we going to be bothered? Are we going to be bothered to do anything? Or are we just going to leave it up to the IT people to do it? How are we going to save our cyber, and what can we as individuals do, whether we're part of a small company or a large company, it's still our responsibility to do something. So my starting point would be Get Safe Online. Get Safe Online is has got both government, business, academic, and other third sector participation. It is a community organisation. The government pays about 70 grand towards this, absolute peanuts, particularly in relation to some of the other investments that it does elsewhere. But the people behind it are all experienced dealing with these issues, and it's probably one of the best libraries of information and dynamic and up-to-date information. For example, when the WannaCry hit, Get Safe Online was live, putting stuff up, helping companies, helping NHS services to understand what's going on. And I would highly recommend it. It's also free. You don't have to pay to join this. And if you want to know about any aspect of cybersecurity or cybercrime, a really good starting point. Most, if not all, police forces will have a link into that. Then you've got Action Fraud. Action Fraud is the UK centre for recording fraud and cyber crime. You can phone them up on the number, or you can go online, actionfraud.police.uk, and you can offer up all the information about an attack that you've had, a phishing attack, for example. If you're getting dodgy emails, you don't know what to do with it, go online and you can post it in so that they can identify some intelligence from it and try and work out who's sending it and get it blocked. Even if all they do is identify the IP address, that can go out nationally so it can be used. Action fraud is both the police, the banks, the government, and the financial institutions of the UK working together. It's a proper partnership funded by government. And again, all the data that they've got on there, all the information, and you can get crime levels or cybercrime levels across the country from it, is free. So then we have the National Cyber Security Centre set up a couple of years ago as part of the Cabinet Office. It helps to govern the way in which the UK manages its cyber. And it sets a strategy which is updated every year. They've just done the first main annual review, and it will help, it will act as a library for information that can be trusted, coming straight from national agencies, including those down in the southwest in Cheltenham, to those in London, the National Crime Agency, the banks, and everybody else. A well-trusted source, ncsc.gov.uk. And they produced what was referred to earlier, the 10 steps. And now, to make it even simpler, if you go on to the NCSC site, they have, for SMEs particularly, 5 steps, which are basic ideas to keep your cyber safe. Some of these things are aimed at larger organisations, but every one of those steps will help any company to look after itself. On the table outside, we've got some information about CISP, and on the reverse of that, if you've got good glasses, you can read about the 10 steps, or better still, go online, NCSC 10 steps, we'll find it for you. Google will find it immediately. Really good advice, and the information that you've had this morning is replicated in those 10 steps there. Tim mentioned Cyber Essentials and Cyber Essentials Plus. This again is the government's way of saying, have you got all this in place? If you have, or you think you have because you've checked yourself, then you are worthy of Cyber Essentials. But if you want somebody else to check it for you, to make sure independently that you've got it, then you would go to Cyber Essentials Plus. And somebody will come in, and as was mentioned earlier, we'll check that you've got all these things in place. We'll do the penetration testing. We'll do just check out and make sure that you're complying. Again, for a small to medium enterprise, Cyber Essentials is essential. And Cyber Essentials Plus, I think, is a really good investment. So moving on from that, if you really want to make sure that your data is as secure as possible, then ISO 27001 security standard meets the best requirements internationally. It's not just about how we operate within the UK, but internationally. And of course, as we're going to have all these new contracts coming with the rest of the world that's not part of EU 27, you will want a standard that operates properly. And ISO 27001 meets that. So that's about the management system, particularly the leadership, the way in which you plan, your improvements, the whole thing. And I think Tim talked particularly about monitoring. You know, how are you monitoring to see that things are doing and people are doing the things that they should do? ISO 27001 really does major on that. So, the purpose of today for me is really also to bring to your attention the CISP. That's not the CRISP, it's the CISP. The Cyber Security Information Sharing Partnership. It is a portal. It's not a network event. You don't have to come every week. There are no conferences organised by CISP. It's merely an online portal to allow you to keep up to date with things that are going on. I'll give you an example. When the WannaCry attacks started, 3 o'clock on the Friday, whenever it, well, I haven't got the exact date, but it's, I remember it's 3 o'clock on the Friday, suddenly started, people wanted to know what to do, and this was heading right the way through the NHS. My son, who's an A&E registrar was telling me about how many things they couldn't do because their systems had been stopped dead in their tracks. So CISP provided an active portal over that period to help health officials, health IT people particularly, and especially NHS Digital, to be able to get an understanding of what's going on, link them to local police response, from local IT response, and start the solutions rolling fairly quickly. Just some numbers. Normally CISP has about 10 messages a day of relevance, or debates ongoing about different things, and I'll give you some examples in a minute. In the first 2 hours of CISP, of the WannaCry attack, there were 300 postings around what can we do, this is happening, where do we get help from? And CISP was used all over the weekend, and it's testament really of the hard work of the health service IT people, because I was monitoring it and they were using it right the way through the night to share ideas and try and get solutions. So it's a really effective portal. And if you look at it the last couple of days, you would have seen a lot of information about the bad rabbit attack and what it can do and how to avoid it. Luckily, it hasn't attacked too many in the UK, although people within, and companies particularly, within Bulgaria, Ukraine, Russia, have not been anywhere near as successful. So what does the CISP contain? What will it give you? Because you're not going to join something, particularly even if it's free, which CISP is, if you don't know what's going on. So this was from about a week or so ago. Information about UK criminal threats, quite high level stuff there. Something about digital currency, people wanted to know how to deal with it, how to get it. Some specific information about attacks and specific information about a particular piece of malware and what it will do. So I thought, well, that's all very well and nice, but what about what's going on now? So on the site at the moment, I just have to make this big because I won't put my glasses on. We've got compromised internal user. This is a number of issues going on that fit quite nicely with the comments that you had, particularly Melanie's comments this morning, about the insider and how they can either maliciously or inadvertently cause problems if you haven't got the right system in place. So there's a debate around there. There's a debate around CyberSafe October 2017. This is from the Northwest Regional Cyber Unit. They're sharing a good practice guide, some useful information to help keep you safe on a monthly basis. Something about advanced persistent threats. These are threats usually from foreign states, and we usually talk about things like North Korea that might have an impact, and some information about that. And then more information particularly about how to manage Bad Rabbit, the NCS, the National Cyber Security Centre Incident Management Alert, telling you about that and giving advice about what to do, A, to prevent it, or B, if you get hit, what to do in order to help rectify it. Suspicious account activity, again, scams that take place where somebody sends you either a text message or an email that says you've got some problems with your phone or with your account, please can you click on here, log in, and we can get it all working right. Or it's a phone call, hi, I'm from the bank, and I want to ask you some questions because there's a security breach. So very specific advice about that to help you. There's also information, for example, Cyber Aware, which is part of the National Cyber Security Centre's, its bottom line protection, has created a new Cyber Aware toolkit, which is aimed at very small businesses and individuals to help them. So that information is first posted on CISP, so you can get it, use it, and it's free. There is no charge for joining CISP. And as I said, more information about Bad Rabbit, some security guidance about Windows 10, and also help with advice and guidance on bring your own device policies. So that's what's being discussed now. That was just before I came up to speak, so that was within the last half an hour or so. That's how valuable being on the CISP is. So what you do in order to join the CISP, it's a very simple process. Basically, all you have to do is go on to that website, ncsc.gov.uk/CISP. And it's free. And on there, you'll be asked for your normal sort of details, name, address, what company, things like that, and your email. You are asked for a sponsor. So if you want a sponsor, then come and see me afterwards. And if you've been at this presentation, we can talk about how you can get on. There may be somebody in your company that is a sponsor. If not, you write to them, and normally they will send it to a regional person like myself to see whether you're who you say you are and check you out. It's not a form of vetting. It's a little bit lower than that, to say the least, but it does mean that we know who is going online. And once you're online, you can receive all the information like that. You can do a network test. You can share information, advice and guidance. And you can enter into conversations with people who are other members. The one thing I will say is it's not an opportunity to market and sell products. So even if you provide the best GDPR training, the best cybersecurity training, you can't advertise on it. It's not a network for advertising. It's not a network from which you will get better or more business. What it is a network that will keep you up to date and help you provide a better service to your customers and those people that you work with, because you have a much better idea about what's going on. And it's something that you can use in order to demonstrate that you are treating cybersecurity properly. So if you're doing those things, Cyber Essentials, you're looking at 10 steps, maybe ISO, and then CISP. All of those things demonstrate that you are serious about cybersecurity and looking after your cyber. So, what we want is for everybody to be bothered, and it isn't just an IT or a technical issue, it's also about everyone, and everyone can play their part in that. And then hopefully you'll be able to demonstrate all the bothers that you've given on cybersecurity. There's two emails up there. One is the company one from AQL. I work for AQL about a day or so a week on behalf of Adam Beaumont for CISP. And that's my company email address there. And just to remind you, ncsc.gov.uk/CISP. And if I haven't said it enough, it's free. You will not be plagued with emails. You will not be spammed. You won't get one of these, thank you for joining CISP, here are some companies that we recommend. There's none of that. It's a straightforward portal to help you to keep alive to all of the latest trends and hopefully to keep your cyber and the cyber of your customers, clients, suppliers, friends and family safe. Thank you very much. Okay, these are the flowers that I've bought. They are from me for Vanessa as a thank you. Unfortunately, you know, Vanessa can't be here. Oh, hang on, sorry. Come out the mic. Just so that we've got that recorded, I'd like just to finally to pay, as I said at the beginning, a big tribute and thanks to Vanessa Smith. I think she's done a really good job getting this regional cyber crime unit working, delivering and reaching out to partners, and it really is appreciated by industry, by academia, and she's built up a really good reputation. I know she's leaving behind an excellent team with a new leader, and I congratulate you on that. But I hope that she gets better soon, and I'd like to ask Belinda to receive this on her behalf and try and get them to her.
Thank you, I'm sure she'll appreciate them. Thank you very much. I'll make sure she gets them.
Thanks.
Right, just a final word from me. Thank you very much for all coming, and I hope we see you in the future. There are some CISP applications at the back that you can take away with you. And obviously some of the notes about keeping yourself safe online. And if you want to take some of them and seek the last opportunity to have a look at the exhibitors out there, that'd be great, and hope to see you in the future.